Chapter 18, Reckless. I paroled back to San Francisco on May 11, 1993. My mom and stepfather were still staying at the Civic Center Hotel on 12th and Market. This was my first stop. I didn't have anything established at the time, but my mom had rented me a room at their hotel in advance and already had it set up for me. My mom was always there for me, and we were really close. She put sheets, blankets, and a comforter on the bed. There were extra towels and pillows, Tupperware bowls, cups, eating utensils, a small TV, and there was even a portable hot plate. That same night, I called Connie, and we ended up going to a small club in downtown San Francisco. To this day, I still remember how good she looked that night. I couldn't take my eyes off her. There was something different about her that humbled me. I knew from that night on, I wanted this woman to be in my life. I was 23 years old, but she made me feel like I was back in high school in puppy love with my high school sweetheart. From that night on, we were inseparable, and she became my girl. About 2 months later, my mom found an apartment on Hillside Boulevard in Daly City, and she asked me to help her move in and get her new place set up. I helped move all her stuff and arrange her furniture. I stayed there with her for the next 3 months. By now, Connie and I were in a committed relationship, and she moved in with me. Although I was eager to function on the streets and contribute to the regiment, there was nobody out there in San Francisco at the time. Little Roach, Dreamer, and everybody else were back in on parole violations, so I really hadn't become actively involved with the street affairs yet. Weasel paroled the same day as me and came by the hotel, but he had never really functioned in the regiment either. Besides, he was running around chasing different women and trying to catch up on missed time like me. When I wasn't with Connie, I spent most of my time running around in my neighborhood gangbanging with the wannabe Southsiders who were trying to make a presence on 19th and Mission. I was still young and hadn't quite grown out of that gangbang mentality yet. Although the NF and NR forbid this type of behavior, I wasn't that educated yet and was still a loose cannon. I was out there acting like a straight idiot, doing dumb shit. The color blue literally triggered a deep hatred inside of me. That's all it took to set me off. If I saw someone wearing blue, it didn't matter what I was doing or who I was with. I'd stop and go after them. Connie was with me during a lot of these incidents, and she saw firsthand how reckless I acted. Connie's mother's apartment was on 16th and Cap. The Sureños posted up on 19th and Mission, and my neighborhood was on 24th and Mission, which meant that I had to pass through their neighborhood to get to mine. This was usually when things would happen. Back then, I used to carry a box cutter and had no discretion when it came to using it. I don't think I ever slowed down long enough to consider the fact that I was placing Connie in harm's way either. All I thought about was trying to exterminate these Sureños and flush them out of my neighborhood. Things got so bad that Connie didn't even want to go out anywhere with me. I was engaging with these fools so much that they knew me by name. She was scared that I'd make a target out of myself. I actually did. And on a few of these occasions, these fools came real close to turning the tables on me and taking me out. Sureño street gangs didn't really begin to evolve and flourish on the streets of Northern California until the mid to early 90s. Although small pockets of them existed in San Francisco as far back as the late 80s. Most of them were paisas, Mexican nationals, with some individuals who were actually born and raised on the streets of Northern California. The infestation of these vagrant Sureño street gangs began to emerge in large numbers and eventually began to try to ensconce themselves in our neighborhoods. In the beginning stages, they were more of a pesky annoyance than anything. But as they began to establish themselves and grow in numbers, they eventually became a hindrance and actually began posing as viable threats. Years later, I would find out that the Mexican Mafia played a big role in this. When I went through the bay on one of my parole violations, I actually had a discussion about this with a Mexican Mafia member who went by the name of No Net. He told me that the MS objective had been to send some of its members to different parts of Northern California for business and financial purposes. The goal was to establish small clandestine footholds and have them move in on some of the criminal enterprise. But as they began establishing themselves in bigger urban cities, they also began using their influence to recruit paisas. These paisas were being influenced into becoming Sureños, and that's how the infestation began. It was analogous to discovering the beginning stages of an errant cockroach problem. If you don't start exterminating them, they begin to procreate and multiply until they're everywhere. In San Francisco, they began trying to establish themselves downtown on 6th and 80 and between 19th and 21st streets on Mission. My relationship with Connie began suffering some real problems when I started to let myself go and slip back into my heroin addiction. I became real abusive and it changed me. I was a different person when I got loaded on that shit. Nobody wanted to be around me. By now, my parole officer was threatening to violate me for being dirty, so I ended up jumping parole. In August 1993, I got picked up for committing another strong-arm robbery with one of my homeboys by the name of Pete Rascal Zamora. Besides Chewy and Weasel, this was probably the only other homeboy from my neighborhood who I was real tight with and who I felt like I could trust. Connie wasn't there when we committed the robbery, but she was with me later on that night when we got arrested. Once again, I was fortunate enough to elude picking up a new case. The district attorney declined to pick up the case, but they sent me back on a violation. This time, they gave me a flat year.